Alec is autistic. He lives in an alien world because he finds it very difficult to understand what makes people tick. Imagine how you would feel if you couldn't work out what was going on in other people's minds or how they were feeling. That's the world of an autistic. When we look at other people, we see through their faces and engage the minds inside. Autistics see only bodies.
What they're seeing is this bag of skin. That's what they're seeing. They're seeing this bag of skin stuffed into clothes, draped over pieces of furniture, with these two little dots at the top that are moving back and forth, and then this hole underneath that opens, closes, and has noises coming out. You can imagine how terrifying, how unpredictable, how confusing it would be to try and make sense out of what all these bags of skin are doing.
For us, the bag of skin comes alive and is animated with mental life. And we can read each other as if we were open books. Can you mind read? Well, see if you can make sense of this. Well, of course, you figured it out, because you put yourself in the woman's head. She thought she recognized the man, only to realize that she'd made an awful mistake, and so she scuttled off, embarrassed, leaving him totally bewildered. Mind reading comes so naturally to us that it's difficult for us to stand back and appreciate it for what it is, an extraordinary gift that sets us apart from all other animal species. We need to compare our minds to the autistic mind to help us understand what we take for granted.
You were telling me earlier that things that you get obsessed about, you can then turn into a picture.
Yeah, well, I mean, bad obsessions about how unfair things are. That'll go round and round and round, and I've drawn it into a picture like this one here.
Tell me about this one.
It's just about, well, basically feeling disgusting aside.
Yeah.
And, like, there's veins coming from the edge, which are all sort of, like, tangled up all over the picture.
Aquinas O'Kell has a mild form of autism called Asperger's syndrome. Simon Baron Cohen calls autism mind blindness, because autistics are unable to read other people's mental states. His research into the autistic mind is producing fascinating new insights into how the normal mind works. It may even help to explain why men and women think so differently that relationships often end up on the rocks. Our trail to the autistic mind starts here in eastern Colorado.
He's doing a real nice job unloading, just letting them take their time, walk off quietly.
Temple Grandin is America's most famous autistic, yet she's a professor of animal science at Colorado State University. She designed much of this feedlot, and it's estimated that 50% of all livestock in America are handled in stockyards and abattoirs designed by her.
If I just sit really quietly and I don't stare at them, see, if I stare at them, they won't come up to me. You know, I've got to make myself little. If I stand up, I'm more scary. Now, if I lay down, I could probably get them all licking me. Maybe I'll do that. There, guys. I just let him come up to me and I don't look him in the eye because he doesn't like that. Well, they're an animal where fear is their main emotion. And fear is also my main emotion.
See, you can just make them come up. You don't even have to shock every one of them. Just walk back by them like that, see? You can make them go up there. You don't have to zap every one of them. Lots of times you can get the cattle to move simply by walking back by them. You just walk back by them, and they go right up the chute. Just walk back by them. When you cross their shoulder, they'll go forward. The mistake that a lot of people make when they handle cattle is they poke at them and prod at them way too much.
Temple has become a byword for the humane treatment of cattle. She's always found it much easier to understand cows than people. Her mind blindness saves her from reading too much into a cow's mind. She simply observes their behavior. Some years ago, she noticed that when cattle were held in the grip of the restraining bars, for the vets to do their work. They changed from being fearfully aroused to being docile. She decided to see if hard hugging would work for her.
Demonstrate how the squeeze machine works. Get in here on my hands and knees. Head through here. This. Control it by operating this lever. When I was a little kid, I would get in under the sofa cushions so that, because I found that that calmed me down. Built my first prototype of it back in high school, and I was so anxious all the time, I just couldn't stand it. It was like I felt like I was in a room with a lion chasing me around, and my nervous system was just in full activation, you know, fight or flight. I was desperate for relief, and I found that if I used the squeezing machine, that helped to calm down my nerves. It makes me have calm and gentle thoughts, sort of like it gets the right neurotransmitters going to have calm feel and nice feelings, you know, rather than not so nice feelings.
Temple is 50 years old, has few friends, prefers to talk shop, and has avoided the complications of sexual relationships all her life. Like the cows in the alien world of the stockyard, Temple has had to fight against the constant fear of living in the alien world of people whose desires, intentions, and emotions are a complete mystery to her. She calls us emotibots and feels like Mr. Spock, living among the crew of the Starship Enterprise.
When I was in high school, I just couldn't figure out, you know, what the other girls were getting so excited about, all the datings with boys and things like that, swooning over the Beatles. And I used to call their behavior interesting sociological phenomena, or ISPs. And, I just felt like I was an anthropologist on another planet trying to figure out what they were doing. I couldn't figure out why I didn't get along with them. I mean, I didn't realize the different ways that people think and that their thoughts are linked with their emotions. I didn't know that.
A recent disaster on the CSU campus gives us a glimpse into how her mind, like Mr. Spock's, separates emotion and reason. 8 inches of rain fell in a matter of hours. The university library flooded out.
We had a tremendous flood here on campus. A meter of water came across campus. The water came in here right under where I'm standing and flooded the basement of the library, and about 100,000 books were totally ruined. Now, some of those journals they can replace, but there was university archives in there. There was Lewis and Clark's original notebooks in there. Some of that stuff, it's gone. Those thoughts are dead. And people are always asking me, well, how do you feel? Well, I'm much more interested in what do I think? And when the library books are ruined, thoughts die. And when the floods came here, I mean, I grieved over the loss of the library. I was at the animal science meetings, and I got to look at the front page of the paper that I got at the hotel, and there was wrecked books all over the place, dumped out all over the place. You know, I just couldn't stop crying about that, because it's thoughts that died, and that's why I get so upset about it. I'm crying about this the way most people cry when they lose a person.
Temple cannot get into human minds, only books. Only when the abstract content of a human mind appears in black and white on the printed page can she let the tears fall. All her life, she's had to teach herself how to understand human emotions as if she was swatting it up in textbooks. Temple may appear outwardly normal, but inside, her brain works furiously to concoct metaphors to help her understand the human behavior around her. It's led to some very bizarre analogies for how people develop close relationships.
When I was in high school, when I was about 16, you know, sort of trying to understand how to interact with people. And the metaphor I used there was a sliding glass door. Not one of the automatic ones, but one you push open manually. And then if you push on it too hard, you're going to break it. You've got to, like, ease it back slowly. You see, now that made a visual picture in my mind that I could understand. Dealing closely with another human being, you had to do it carefully, because if you did what I called pushing and pounding on the door, you would break the door. You don't rush into it. In high school and college, I did doors. But then as I built up more stuff from reading Newsweek and Time and the Wall Street Journal and the New York Times and whatnot,
Then I had a whole bunch of diplomatic information from the newspaper that I used as a scaffold to understand in relationships with people.
Over her lifetime, that database has expanded so much. It's as if her brain is a network of huge library computers linked by the internet.
It's just like having a computer inside your head, and you go to web pages, and it comes up as still pictures first, and then turns into video. And if I'm just like flicking quickly from one page to another, it will just stay freeze frames. I can go boom, 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 just look at freeze frames. But if I stop on any one web page in my mind, then it turns into video.
We had a tremendous flood here on campus. A meter of water came across campus.
Temple continually surfs her internal mindscape, pulling out relevant video clips of previous experiences and editing them into a quick-time self-help movie designed to guide her in any social situation.
The way my database works is just like a real high-speed modem. You know, I go find other web pages of situations that are similar situations, compare them and contrast them.
But it's not instantaneous. I have to still download them. Might be a really fast hookup, but it's not an instant hookup. I gotta download the stuff, I gotta look at it, compare it and contrast it, and I don't handle things under pressure well.
Temple's mental supercomputer tries to replace what Daniel, 1 year old, is already starting to grasp. The intuitive understanding of the mind that makes us humans unique.
Hello.
From very early on in infancy, babies are looking not just at the mother, but at the mother's face. And not just at the face, but at the eyes. They seem to spend longer looking at the eye region of the face than at any other part of the body. In turn, mothers are spending a long time looking at the eyes of the baby, providing long opportunities for the baby to examine the face of another person and really start learning about faces and what's behind them. Infants not only follow where somebody else is looking, what we might call gaze monitoring, but they also try and direct where other people are looking by using the pointing gesture. They'll point at something, look back at the adult's face, and keep pointing until the adult has looked at what the infant is interested in.
Simon Baron Cohen's colleagues have been testing toddlers for several years to see how they use this interaction when the unexpected happens.
When a toddler enters a new situation, there might be a novel object or a new person. They don't know whether it's a safe object or whether it's a dangerous object. The first thing they often do is that they look up at the face of the caregiver to get reassurance or to get a sign of warning whether to approach or to avoid that object. What we find is that children who simply look at the toy but don't look up at the adult's face, who don't show social referencing, are at much greater risk for developing autism.
Between 18 months and 6 years, normal children pass rapidly through a number of stages on the road to mind reading. Alison Gopnik and her team have devised an ingenious series of tests to determine what those stages are and when they come about. First comes a child's understanding that different people can have different wants or desires.
So here was our idea. Suppose you take something very basic about what I like and what you like, which is the kind of food that we like. That's something that even very little babies know about. So we set up this situation in which the other person is expressing, telling the child that their desires, their likes, their wants are different from those of the child. And the question is, can the child use that information to make an inference about what my mental state is, even when that mental state is different from their own? Watch. Watch. Look. Ooh, yuck! Ew! I tasted the crackers. Ooh, yuck! Ooh! I tasted the crackers! Okay, now look, Simon, look. Mmm! Broccoli! Mmm! Look, Simon. Mmm! I tasted the broccoli. Now, Simon? Could you give me some? Could you give me some? Very good, thank you.
So what we found was that children younger than 18 months, about 14 months old, would consistently act as if we wanted the same thing they did. In other words, even though we'd said, yuck, crackers, and yum, broccoli, the children themselves clearly so much themselves liked the crackers, so much themselves wanted the crackers, that they attributed that desire to us too.
By the time he's 2 years old, Simon will understand that people's desires can be different.
A more abstract idea is that I could conceive of the world differently than you. Even if I see the same thing, the way I interpret that thing could be different. The way I think about it, the ideas I have about it could be different from the ideas that you have about it. And that seems to be something that doesn't develop until still later, so that our three-year-olds, who can understand that you could see something differently from me, don't understand that you could represent something differently from me, or that you could believe something different about it than I do. Well, one situation in which you have to understand that the same object could be interpreted or represented in different ways is in something like an ambiguous figure, like the famous duck rabbit.
What is this a picture of? Can you look at this picture? Okay, what's it, what do you see? What is it a picture of?
A duck.
A duck, okay. Is there anything else this could be a picture of? What else?
A goose.
A what?
A goose.
A goose, okay. Well, you know what else this could be a picture of? It could be a bunny. Can you see a bunny? Okay, where would the bunny's, where are the bunny's ears? There, okay. Where's the duck's beak? There, okay. So now, here's the fun part. Let's look at this picture, and this is a special picture because when you look at it, it might change back and forth from a bunny to a duck.
What we've discovered is that even when you explain at great length the two different interpretations to young children, say to four-year-olds, they still have a lot of difficulty switching back and forth from one representation to another. And the 3 and 4-year-olds that we've tested simply say it doesn't switch back and forth from one object to another. They just don't experience multiple representations of the same object. And it's only when they're about 5 or 6 that you suddenly start seeing them reacting to these ambiguous figures the same way an adult would and saying, okay, wait a minute, hey, look, it switched. It looked like a duck, and now it looks like a rabbit. Our adult conception of the mind deeply depends on the idea that we have these states like beliefs, what philosophers call intentional states, that have this property of referring to the external world but still being able to be different from the external world, being wrong or being opposite to the external world. And that basic idea that you could split up what the world is like and what your mind is telling you about the world, that seems to be something that children are only discovering when they're 4 or 5 years old.
A mind that can understand ambiguous figures can understand that two people can have totally different beliefs about the world. These kids are 6-year-old psychologists with their own homegrown theories of mind. Mentally, they're a world apart from these autistic children. Their mind blindness explains their lack of social behavior. Many young autistics are also profoundly disadvantaged. They have low IQs and fail to develop language properly. They're trapped in an undecipherable solitary world. In contrast, Alec, Robert and Josh are the more able pupils at this special school for autistics. They're between 9 and 11 years old, but without these special lessons, they would be unable to understand what a smile was, or to recognize whether a person was happy or sad from the expressions on their face.
Go next.
Is she happy or is she not happy, Josh?
I think she's looking a bit dull and tired.
A bit tired?
Mm.
Do you think she's happy?
Well, I suggest that, well, I think she's looking a bit unhappy because she's hurt herself from her bike.
I see, so she's not happy. Josh, can you go and put that picture on the board?
The classic test for mind reading is called the Sally Ann. It's a test that normal kids are expected to pass when they're 5 years old.
Who'd like to go next?
Right, okay, this is Sally, and this is Anne. Which one's Sally?
This one. Well done, right. And Sally has got a basket. And Anne has got a box. Nothing in it. And Sally has got a marble. And Sally puts her marble into her basket to keep it safe while she goes outside to play. But while Sally's outside, naughty Anne moves the marble from Sally's basket into her box. Naughty Anne. So where's the marble now?
Box.
Good. Where did Sally put the marble in the beginning?
Basket.
In the basket. Well done. So when Sally comes back from playtime, where will she look for her marble?
In the box.
Robert should have said the basket, because that is where Sally, in her ignorance, would have thought it was. He hasn't mind-read the situation from her point of view. What is it about the autistic brain, which means that children like Robert may never be able to mind-read like the rest of us?
Apparently, Kotex have just cut a hole in their new ultra-thin. Why? Unbelievably, it's the hole in the new Kotex Ultra that makes it work so well. Liquid goes straight down to the bottom layer, and because almost nothing can come back up again, you'll feel really dry and comfortable. The new Kotex Ultra-Thin. Protection never felt like this.
For Christmas gift ideas, turn to Argos. The Filishave Reflex Action. Closer contact for a closer shave. The Filishave Reflex Action at Argos. For thousands of gift ideas and more besides, Argos takes care of it.
Feeling you've lived before. I know I have. I've been a Dublin bricklayer. I've been a Yorkshire coal miner. And I've been a Bombay curry taster. That's why today there's a stout drinker, a bitter drinker, and a lager drinker in me.
It's creamy. It's smooth. It's refreshing. It's called a Calder's.
Where have you been all my lives?
How long? A few minutes.
About 10 minutes?
5 minutes and it's all over.
What do you get out of your lozenge?
A lot more than that.
Fairwaves, the amazing new vapor-release chewing gum from Wrigley's. It tastes great, and every chew releases wave after wave of fast-acting menthol and eucalyptus vapors to help clear your nose. It goes on and on. New sugar-free Wrigley's Airwaves, long-lasting vapor-release gum.
There are angels on the streets of Dublin that come down to tempt the likes of me. Did you hurt yourself when you fell from the heavens? Let's stop a short while and have a look at you. Your eyes are a terrible curse to a fellow like myself. And your beautiful hair.
It's all gone.
Jameson. Triple distilled to be the smoothest of the smooth.
Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday dear Katie.
Katie Bierfeld and her friends have Williams syndrome, a rare developmental disorder of the brain which leaves them mentally retarded. Most of them will never learn any real academic skills. Yet in direct contrast to autistics, they're born mind readers. Although their IQs can be as low as 60.
I don't know which one I'm going to open first.
They have rich use of language, are vivid socializers, and play pretend games.
For casting a spell. You're casting a spell on him.
Oh. Turn to a frog. Turn to a rat.
Turn to a rat.
Turn me to something.
Turn you into a dragon. Turn you into a nice woman.
I love you, Georgie.
The child with Williams syndrome is enormously interested in the other children in the group. They will go up to them, they will communicate with them, they will want to engage with them, they will express sympathy at their distress, they will express happiness at their joy, they will go up and greet the other children. You will see none of those behaviors in autism.
Psychologists believe they are the opposite of autism because, despite their low IQs, they have a much better grasp of other people's mental states.
Very nice. That was great.
Now, Beck, what do you think is in this box?
Crayons.
You think there's crayons in there? How about if we open it up and see? Okay, why don't you open it up? Check it out. Here, you want to open it?
Nothing.
Nothing? Hmm. I bet there's something in there. Look.
Band-aid.
A Band-Aid. Do you believe that? I tricked you. You thought there were going to be
crayons
in there, but
why did you have Band-Aid?
Well, because I'm tricky. I wanted to trick you. So let's put the Band-Aid back in and close the box all up tight like this. Now, Becky, let me ask you, what's really in the box?
Band-Aid.
A Band-Aid. Now, Becky, let's say that your mom came in and we showed her the box closed up tight. Would she know what's inside? No. What would she think is inside?
Crayons.
She'd think there were crayons in there? Oh, my goodness.
When we give children and even adults tasks that tap into their ability to interpret people as mental beings, that people have mental states. They have desires, they have emotions, they have basic cognitive states like forgetting and knowing and so forth. We give them tasks that just tap into that, the children with Williams syndrome do remarkably well. They really are remarkably good at their understanding of people as mental beings.
Maude, why does Sally begin to run when the dog gets up and barks?
Because the dog is so wild and she thinks it's a monster because
a part of their brain that is responsible for mind reading has survived the syndrome unscathed. Within the brain at large, there is a structure that specifically deals with social intelligence, a social brain.
Because the dog was running. So, Maude, what's going on inside Sally's head when the dog gets up and barks like that?
Scared.
Scared. Very good. Excellent job.
Part of that social brain is situated here, deep in the temporal lobes, an evolutionarily ancient region of the brain, a nut-sized organ called the amygdala.
What's quite remarkable about their brains is that although overall their brains are smaller, even in absolute size, their amygdalas seem to be of normal size. So they're equivalent to the size of the amygdala and the associated regions that we see in normally developing children of the same age.
The Williams syndrome children have given us a vital clue to where the social brain is. Scientists have long suspected that the amygdala is involved in understanding emotions, but thanks to MRI brain scanners, they can now see exactly what turns the amygdala on in real time. The subject is shown a succession of fearful or threatening faces while her brain is scanned. Here, the scanner is slicing its way vertically through her brain from ear to ear.
Nancy
Etkoff and Hans Breiter have found that parts of the amygdala light up in response to the fearful faces, while other parts of the amygdala respond to happiness.
I would expect that the amygdala is involved in a whole range of expressions, particularly since it's so involved in threat. We would assume that anger and expression of anger We might also expect it to be involved in situations of loss, of sadness, of having to learn from that sort of experience as well. My guess is that it will be involved in quite a range of emotion.
We wanted to put together a set of pictures of facial expressions that would really assess the whole range of human emotion, not just the basic emotions like happy, sad, angry, and afraid, but the more complex or cognitive emotions. Sometimes when an emotional expression changes, it's very dramatic. Something fearful happens and the whole face becomes fearful. Something surprising happens and the whole face changes. But often, changes in emotion are much more subtle, and you may not see a big change in the mouth, but you may see a very subtle change in what goes on around the eyes. And we appear, as mind readers, to be very skilled at picking up even these minute changes in information around the eyes to work out that the person may be slightly anxious, may be slightly sad, or may be simply being reflective.
Baron Cohen's team showed volunteers this series of photographs where they had to read the mind in the eyes and choose between two interpretations while their brains were scanned. They hypothesized that normal subjects would rely heavily on the amygdala, while autistic subjects might not.
What we found is that in the normal case, as predicted, the amygdala is very active in this task. In contrast, and quite impressively, the people with autism were using different brain areas, but not the amygdala, in processing this information.
The amygdala can successfully mind-read emotional expressions, even when other parts of the brain are unable to recognize the face they belong to.
Some years ago, when I was attending a conference in Boston, and at some point during the conference, I had to leave the auditorium where the conference was being held to use the lavatory. On my way back from the lavatory, I came around a corner and saw someone whom I thought was a former supervisor of mine and greeted him. But there was no response. I looked again and found that I was looking at a mirrored wall and therefore at myself, the stranger in the mirror.
L.H. was brain injured in a car crash when he was an undergraduate. The parts of his temporal lobes responsible for face recognition were damaged beyond repair.
When I first met L.H., one interesting question to me was how he recognized his wife. He had met his wife and married after the accident, and I wondered when they went out, did he at least know her, or how would he identify her? And he told me that she needed to wear a ribbon in her hair, and that he would recognize the ribbon, but not his wife. One time I was driving him home after testing, and I pulled up to his house, and in the driveway were two children, and I said, "Are those your children?" He said, "Must be. They're in my driveway." He can't recognize family members. He can't recognize a picture of himself. He's never recognized me, and I've been testing him now for over 8 years. Lincoln, I'm going to show you pictures of faces, and they're going to have different emotional expressions on them. I want you to tell me which expressions on the face, using one of these categories, happy, sad, angry, fearful, disgusted, or surprised. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Here's the first face.
Etkoff believes that LH's amygdala survived the accident, so that he can recognize facial expression.
Angry.
A more advanced part of his social brain, in the frontal lobes, responsible for turning information from the amygdala into appropriate social behavior, has also survived.
LH is much better at recognizing emotion from the face than he is at recognizing identity. He can recognize happiness and sadness, disgust, the basic emotions. He is not as good as most people are. He isn't as good as you and I are at it, but he is able to differentiate, you know, basic moods and feelings from the face. He clearly is able to recognize emotions, intentions. He knows when someone's interested in him, is looking at him. He's also taken social jobs, jobs which require him to understand social cues. He's been a minister and a social worker. So this suggests that there's a separate circuitry in the brain for social functions, the amygdala in particular, and the orbital frontal regions seem to be the core of what we call the social brain.
Meet Mr. Phineas Gage, or at least what's left of him. He's going to show us exactly where this vital second component of the social brain is situated. Phineas was involved in a gruesome accident in 1848 while working on the construction of a railroad in Vermont. An iron tamping bar, 3 feet long and 1.5 inches in diameter, shot through his skull at explosive speed. It entered alongside his jawbone, passed under the cheekbone, traversed the orbit of his left eye, and smashed through his skull to land over 100 feet away. Incredibly, he survived the accident and lived on for another 10 years with most of his faculties intact. The only thing that went to pieces was his social behavior. He went from being an affable, sociable man with a charismatic personality to a morose, foul-mouthed bore who couldn't foster social relationships or hold down a job. Scientists at the University of Iowa decided to reconstruct Phineas's brain to see if they could estimate how much of it had been destroyed. Using powerful computers, they calculated the position of the entry and exit points of the iron bar and its likely trajectory through the brain. Luckily for Phineas, it seemed to have passed point first between the two lobes of the frontal cortex. The main damage had been sustained by an area just above the bony orbit of the eye, the orbitofrontal cortex. This damage to his orbitofrontal cortex had caused the abrupt and disastrous change in his social behavior. This is the way modern Phineases are created.
What happens with head trauma, your head is hit, the head stops, it decelerates. The brain, which is loose in the cranial vault, starts bouncing back and forth. At first it bounces off this side, the back, let's say you landed here, but this is pretty smooth, so it doesn't do much mechanical damage. It then bounces back in the other direction and hits these jagged areas, these bony ridges in the, that are marking off the temporal lobe and parts of the orbital frontal area. When the brain hits these bony ridges, there's mechanical damage, just as if you were getting cut or scraped on your arm, damages the orbital front of the brain sitting here and the anterior temporal part.
Matthew Rooney is a modern Phineas. He damaged his orbitofrontal cortex in a motorbike crash 20 years ago. Since then, he has suffered a string of disastrous relationships and believes he was cynically set up by his second wife.
The only one that actually told me that we had a problem was my second wife. On the way out of the courthouse, she let me know that she was not planning on living or sleeping with me. That in actuality she got married to me for the green card, which took me totally by surprise.
I see.
Did not make me angry, which I thought was most interesting.
Do you still find yourself attracted to women?
Furiously. Yes, it's a non-stop thing that I consider to be a problem at this point. I think that I'm perhaps not more attracted than the next guy, but more willing to stare.
Exactly how are the two main components of the social brain, the amygdala and orbitofrontal cortex, working together to produce good social behavior and a theory of mind?
We think that these two brain areas, the amygdala and the orbitofrontal region of the brain, are working together as part of a network in what some people call the social brain. That whilst the amygdala is processing information of quite a low level, like faces, emotions, and what the eyes are doing, the orbitofrontal and other prefrontal areas are using that information in planning, in particular social planning, working out what's the appropriate thing to do in any given situation, working out what somebody else might know given their past history, and that these two regions are working collaboratively to give the individual a theory of mind.
How are psychologists pulling all this science together to explain why relationships between men and women so often end in disaster?
That's a family of four. They're over 2,000 feet away. Can you hear them? A shark can. And you can reach them in less than 45 seconds. Discovery Channel. What's really happening?
Mr. Johnson to see you.
Hello. Welcome to Kenko. Take a seat.
I'll make this short. I'm sure we're both very busy.
Can I get you a coffee, Mr. Johnson?
Do you have decaf?
I'll have a look.
Right, I'll come straight to the point.
Coffee.
Thank you. So you didn't have decaf then?
No, I didn't. But you did.
Kenko decaffeinated everything we know about coffee in a decaf.
There's a powerful remedy for the four main symptoms of flu. Benylin 4 flu reduces fever, relieves aches and pains, soothes coughing, combats congestion, and so aids restful sleep. Benylin 4 flu, for powerful flu relief.
Travelling around the world, one thing has become clear. When we show people what the Pentium 2 processor can do for a PC, they want to get it. Except the kids. Kids already get it.
Oi! What do you think you're doing?
Peanut Lion.
I've warned you two about this before!
It's a totally different animal.
She didn't. He did. Now you can. Ring 0345 321234 for your free sample of Kenko Decaf.
Yeah, they were in here drinking Tia Maria with cola. Then in walked Harry. Right before my eyes, I swear, they turned one Harry into three. Just for the hell of it.
When you walk the streets, what worries you most? Muggers? Drunks? Thugs? Or meteorites? Up to 18,000 crash through the atmosphere every year and don't stop until they hit something. Discovery Channel. What's really happening?
Scorpio.
No.
On Jet's not there anymore, lightning.
There seems to be an extraordinary link between autism and the way a normal man's mind works. A vital clue to that link involves a rare female genetic disorder. Kylie Smythe is 10 years old and has Turner syndrome. Normally, girls inherit two X chromosomes, one from their mother and one from their father. But in Turner syndrome, one of those X chromosomes goes missing. This causes their small physical size, but some Turner syndrome girls, like Kylie, also developed severe problems with their social behaviour.
They weren't able to mix with the other children. They felt that they didn't have any friends. They felt very insecure. Even something as simple as setting her place in the morning at a different side of the table. That can disturb her, and it means that she forgets the next thing. It's almost as if she does it in a list. And if you remove one of the orders, then it's almost panic. But it's these little things that distress her quite greatly.
The girl's parents enlisted the help of behavioural scientist David Skews in London. He soon came up with an extraordinary finding.
When we looked at those girls who just had one X chromosome, and we divided those into two groups, those in whom that single X came from the mother and those in whom the single X came from the father, overwhelmingly, the social difficulties were among those girls in whom that single X chromosome had its origin in the mother, and that the girls whose single X came from their father had relatively few problems.
When any woman is carrying the X chromosome, vital genes on it become switched off. Mothers then pass those silent genes onto their children. What does David Skews think those genes should have been doing?
Because we know that the differences in the behaviour and cognitions of these two groups of girls, depending on the parental origin of their single X chromosome, is essentially social. And we know that individuals with damage or other impairment to the development of their prefrontal cortex, the frontal parts of the brain that are most highly developed in humans, leads to social impairment. Then our suspicion is that these genes are influencing the development of the frontal parts of the brain.
About a year ago, she said to my sister she didn't like her hairdo, she thought it was horrible. My sister was offended. Kylie didn't understand why she was offended, because that was her opinion. But only recently Kylie said to me that she has realised that if she'd thought about how my sister felt, then she wouldn't have said it, because she would have found it offensive.
She asked us all to be truthful with her, so I was, and but now, about a year after, I thought I shouldn't have done that. That must have hurt her feelings, because I had learnt what it was like to be hurt that way.
Oh my goodness, beautiful. Isn't that gorgeous?
Autism is normally very rare in girls, affecting less than 1 in 10,000. Yet David Skews found that in the group of girls who only had their mother's X chromosome, the incidence of autism was 400 times higher than normal. One sweeping glance inside a school for autistic children reveals a stark fact that autism is up to 10 times more common in boys than girls. And there is only one place that any boy can get the X chromosome that gives him his normal XY makeup, his mother. How could human evolution have favoured a genetic mechanism that carried so high a risk of autism?
We propose that the inheritance of a switched-off copy of this gene gave males an evolutionary advantage. Of course, it's highly speculative as to what that advantage must have been, but it must have been pretty important, because it was at the expense of a pretty large disadvantage as well, which was the increased male risk of autism and autistic-like disorders.
In Cambridge, Simon Baron Cohen thinks he knows what that male advantage is. His group has been testing high-functioning autistics like Aquinas, their parents, and normal men. A pattern has emerged.
Okay, Aquinas, I'm going to show you some pictures of faces. For each face, there are two words at the bottom of the page. Yeah. And I want you to choose the word that best describes what the person in the picture is thinking or feeling.
Fine.
Okay, and I want you to try and do it as fast as you possibly can.
Okay.
Okay,
yeah.
Ready?
Ready.
Okay, let's go.
Unconcerned. Noticing you. Attraction. Relaxed.
They found that autistics do much worse on this test of reading the mind in the eyes than controls. They also find that the non-autistic parents of autistics do relatively badly, and so do normal men compared to women.
Sad reflection.
Okay, Aquinas, this time round we've got a colourful display with a very simple shape next to it, and the idea of this task is you've got to find this very simple shape somewhere in this colourful display.
Okay,
so it's just this outline you're looking for.
Yeah.
So you ready?
Yeah.
Okay, let's see the next one.
In contrast, autistics, the parents of autistics, and normal men do better on visuospatial tests like this recognition of embedded figures. Autistics and normal men share the same bias in their cognition towards the abstract physical world and away from the intuitive and social world.
Well, in any population, you'd expect 5% of males to be working in a field like engineering. What we found amongst the fathers of children with autism was that about 12% of them were working in that field, so that's more than double. And that was also true for grandfathers on either side of the family. It looks like in the normal case that the male brain preferentially attends to spatial information and into understanding physical systems outside of the social domain. And in contrast, the female brain, if you like, is attending more to faces, we see this in female babies, and is showing a greater aptitude on social reasoning tests. In the case of autism, it looks like there is this strong preference for processing information about physical systems, machines, geographical information, train information, these sorts of things, with a relatively less developed skill in processing social information, suggesting that autism, genetically, might be at an extreme point on this male brain continuum.
This is G6ELH Mobile, George 6 Echo Lima Hotel Mobile, listening AM. Anybody out there?
This predisposition of men to autism could be the price men pay for the way the male brain works. In that case, where on the male continuum would you place Chris Slater Walker?
We have regular competitions. What you do is basically, they last about 24 hours. You go out somewhere in the countryside, preferably on top of a hill or a mountain or something like that, and you simply attempt to contact, you just make very short contacts with as many people as possible, as far away as possible, and you score points depending on how far away they are.
We started replacing our record collection with CDs, and we very quickly amassed a fair number, and Chris decided he would put these in a better order, and he arranged them in order of the date of birth of the composer, which I wasn't very happy with because I don't know the dates of birth of the composers.
Hi, G7BZV Mobile, G6ELH Mobile.
Chris would come into the house and it wouldn't occur to him that he should say hello. I think he probably thought that because the door had banged I would know he was there. And he would go straight into the kitchen and he would immediately start hoovering the working surfaces.
The name of this side is Chris. I'm on the A41, somewhere between Tringen and Himmel Hempstead.
These things, you just tend to accept them and think that they're eccentricities. And yet, thinking back, it's really quite unusual to lie down in the middle of the floor on a social occasion and go to sleep.
I've just cleared Hangar Lane, heading due west on the M40 at the moment.
I wonder what the name was. I didn't catch it from G6ELH Mobile.
He's not very good at gauging when I'm upset. I have learnt that I have to tell him that I'm upset and precisely why. And sometimes he's been surprised. Once he said, I thought you could cope with everything.
Chris is a computer expert. He and Gisela live in Watford. They've been married for 6 years and have a son, George. So obsessive, emotionally cold, and socially awkward was Chris that the whole fabric of their marriage was in danger of falling apart. It was then that Gisela happened to read an account of Temple Grandin in Oliver Sacks' book Anthropologists on Mars. The penny dropped.
It was the social difficulties, I think, and the sort of feelings that she was quite different that Chris had talked about, particularly when he was at school. And then after that, I'd showed the book to Chris, and Chris identified with a fair amount of it. I think she describes her father as remote and pedantic, which could be applied to Chris.
I can remember feeling that when we were at school at playtime, a lot of the children seemed to be apart from a lot of the other children. I would usually have a couple of friends, but really not many, and my participation in the kind of games that the vast majority of the children would be playing, well, I just didn't. I had a chemistry set which I used to spend, I mean, literally hours, I think, playing with. And at a fairly early age, I got interested in electronics as well. In my emotional life at that time was really very limited, I think. And I mean, friends said that, well, Chris, you don't seem to have any emotions. Why is this? And I didn't know, but I thought, well, it's just me, you know.
Well, we're going to walk towards the back.
They went to see a consultant psychologist, and Chris was immediately diagnosed as having Asperger's syndrome.
Well, I think it's probably made the difference between us staying together and not staying together. I can appreciate Chris's good points a lot more. And I know how to handle the things that sort of really threatened our happiness before. And I think Chris is learning. Chris is responding differently.
If I've seen that she's upset, and it might not be with, not necessarily upset with me or something I've done, then I often found that very, very forbidding and difficult to deal with. But I know now that what she wants is she wants a hug or something like that. And I can go ahead and do that, and that's, you know, that's made an enormous difference, just that simple thing. I was feeling like, you know, why should I even bother to try and get on with people? Why should I try and go out? Why should I try and have a relationship with anybody? Because there's no hope. Basically, there's no hope that I could be any good in society at all. You know, the feeling of loneliness and isolation, which I'd often had before, is kind of multiplied many times over. Now we have a basis for making some kind of progress. I mean, I take a lot of guidance from Gisela because I've always felt, rightly or wrongly, that she has such a deep understanding of people. I mean, you know, I'm always willing to do what she thinks is best in that kind of area.
Help networks for autistics are beginning to report a small avalanche of cases of late diagnosis, like Chris. There's a mountain of Asperger's syndrome out there, masquerading as male marital incompetence. The gulf between Chris Slater Walker and most men may not be very wide. As we've long suspected, men make the perfect nerds, and women are far better mind readers.
Think. Want. Believe. Expect. Remember. Doubt. Imagine.
Guess. Pretend. Consider. Reason. Desire. Forget. Realize.
Ignore. Decide. Attend. Plan. Wish.
Hope.
If you'd like further information about help for people with autism or related conditions like those seen in tonight's Equinox, you can call the Channel 4 information line on 0345 59 1010. Lines are open 24 hours a day for the next month and calls will cost no more than 20 pence. Equinox is back in 2 weeks' time.